Okay, we're back. 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a beautiful Sunday afternoon. I'm Sheila Reed, your host of the Jazz Festival. And of course, as I mentioned earlier today, if you've been listening in the radio world in this region, St. Louis, Missouri, has lost one of our greats. And that is the wonderful, very talented radio personality for many, many years, Mr. Michael Bishop, who is from St. Louis, Missouri. And Michael, I must say that he started with me many years ago, and I'll tell you more about that. And as of recent, Michael was on a radio show with our wonderful dear friend Edie B., who is now with a radio program here with us at Mix 99.5 FM. Edie is in the studio with me today. And can you hear me okay, Edie?
I can hear you fine. Can you
okay,
hear
great.
I can hear myself.
Okay, let's see if we can... Okay, great. All right, so we just want to elaborate a little bit about Michael. First of all, our hearts go out to the family and friends of Michael, just as ourselves. Yeah. And Edie, just tell everyone, first of all, about most recently. We'll go from current to going backwards, okay, as our experience with Michael
well,
and
Sheila,
knowing him.
I met Michael... I don't think I'm registering that. I can't hear myself. So,
1 second. We're going to get this straight here in just 1 second.
Okay. Why don't you go to some music and we'll
yeah. Hang on. We're going to let you hear Michael's favorite song that he used to
this
open
is,
up the show with.
Michael's theme song.
His theme song as well from his show. For the old show, Harmony Show. So we're going to let you listen to that for just a second. Thank you. Okay, we're back, and sorry about that.
Okay, I can hear myself now.
Great,
yeah.
That's great. Hopefully you guys can hear us very clearly. In the background, as I mentioned, the theme song for Michael Bishop from the old Harmony Show.
Yeah, the old Soul Harmony Show on KDHX, and Michael, every time Michael came on every Saturday, this is the song that he played, and this is John Coltrane's Dear Lord. And I don't know if you remember this or not, Sheila, but a few years ago, Michael called me and asked me to be his co-host.
I do.
But I was not the first choice.
Oh,
you were the first choice.
I remember that. I remember that very clearly.
Yes.
Yes.
And I didn't know Michael. He said he knew me from back when we worked at that jazz station
KBDY.
Together.
KBDY.
Okay.
Right.
And I didn't remember Michael from back then. And I told him the reason why I probably didn't remember him is because I was going through so much stuff.
Right.
It's best that he didn't know me during that time. He would have had a heck of a friend. Truly.
Oh.
But...
We all go through things, Edie,
absolutely,
and that's okay.
But I did eventually go to work with him. At the time that he asked me, I was writing my play, and he wanted me to come on with him at the time. So I took about a month or so before I actually went on the air with him. And when I went on the air with him, I thought that I had finished my play. But what was so unique when I... you know, when somebody asks you to go on their show and co-host, you know, you want to study them and see what kind of show it was and all that.
Right.
And the first thing I heard was this song, Dear Lord, by John Coltrane. Now, you know, jazz is my thing.
Exactly, which was music
so
to your ears.
I listened to a little bit more after the jazz tune, and then he played a really nice oldie. I'm like, wow, this is the kind of show that, you know, that I want to do, right?
Yes.
So after I got there and started working with him, I discovered that no, it was not a jazz show at all. It's not even a show where you intermingle with jazz.
Right, right.
It was just basically an oldie show.
Sure.
But It wasn't the kind of oldie show that you just naturally hear that you and I would probably do.
That's right.
Michael was sort of what you would call a teacher of our history of soul music. And I like that because we have kind of gotten away from it. You know, we speak of Sam Cooke and Otis Redding and people like that. But our younger folk, they don't know too much about Sam Cooke or
they
Otis
really
Redding.
Don't.
And even the early Aretha Franklin, a lot of them don't know how deep into jazz and soul that she was.
Just as Marvin Gaye.
Absolutely, absolutely. So when I started working with Michael, that is what I saw him doing, and I just fell in love with his show, fell in love with Michael, because he was just a light. I mean, the sweetest man you ever want to meet.
He really, really was.
And the first time I showed up, he had his wife Sharon with him, and I thought about it. I says, you know, you come from back in the day when you're just one of the guys on the air.
Right.
I'm a girl, but I was just one of the guys
yes.
on the air.
Yes.
And showing up for Michael's show, he brought his wife with him. Because you got to think about the time that he's on the air. He's on the air from 5 a.m. till 7 a.m. Now, that's at night. I mean, that's kind of nighttime-ish for a young lady to be out and about. But he thought about that, and he wanted me to feel comfortable. He wanted me to know that he was strictly about business. He brought his wife
yes,
with
yes.
him. I love that. I love men who
yes.
I love men who are married who love their wives.
You better believe
and
me.
Not afraid
too.
To tell anybody that
exactly.
they love them.
Exactly.
Yes.
Put them on a pedestal.
But that was Michael.
Yes.
That was Michael. And after I got there, I found out that I wasn't finished writing my play. Because it seemed like the first week I was there, he wanted to, he had booked an interview with Mickey Stevenson.
I remember you told
yes,
me that story.
Mickey
you
Stevenson
told all of us.
Was, yeah, was the first A&R man for Motown
mm-hmm,
Records.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm writing this play about Marvin Gaye wanting to be a jazz singer. And Mickey Stevenson was instrumental in helping Marvin Gaye forget about wanting to be a jazz singer.
Right.
So
right.
I was able to interview Mickey Stevenson and Art Stewart, which were really advantageous for my play.
Yes.
And Michael loved the play. He loved doing the interviews and helping me with it and all that. And you know, I thought I can do this, and
okay.
I know I can.
Yes, you
but
can.
Michael was, he was beyond the words that I have to describe him.
I know that.
He was just such a sweet guy.
And, he really was.
And I think during the time that I was working with him, I think he was sick then.
Yes.
I just didn't know, and he was not the type of person to talk about himself.
No.
He talked about
wasn't.
His family, he talked about his wife, he
and
talked
his
about
music.
The music. Mostly to us,
yes.
he talked about the music.
Yes.
And I don't want to carry on with this interview, sweetie. I could just go on and on and on.
I know. And I just want to elaborate, too, very quickly. Michael and I started with KBDY as well, mm-hmm. as you well know, back in 1986.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And when Michael had his radio show, you know what? God forgive me. I can't recall the name of the show. But it was all jazz.
Yeah, it
related.
Was all straight ahead jazz.
Yes, it was.
Right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And We all got along. We were family there
right.
at that station, along with Hank Thompson
right.
and Scotty Lawrence,
yes.
and better known AKA as
yes.
Rob Salter, you know, Robert Salter,
Sheila,
our dear
during
friend.
During the time that I was
yes,
there,
yes,
but
I
during
know,
the time
yes.
that I was on the air at that time, it was one of the worst times in my life. You guys probably didn't know it.
No. What was the problem?
Oh, no, you don't want it. We would have to do another radio show okay. and probably have to have a series of shows to
yes.
tell you about. That
yes,
but
yes.
but I made it through
yes
yeah
Michael was extremely warm
I just
funny
don't
and he,
him
I've never there. Seen him with not a smile on his face
absolutely you, let me tell you this little story about Michael when I came to work for him and he saw that I was writing the play you know just and then after I interviewed you know, with the people that he had booked for his show, mm-hmm. and they were advantageous to my play. When we would get off the air, we would go into the other control rooms at the radio station at KDHX, we would talk about the interview and we would talk about different ways that I could put them in my play and stuff like that.
Sure.
But Michael shared something with me one time after we got off the air. He wrote a poem. And if you know anything about Michael, and I'm sure it struck you, Michael was very shy.
Yes,
you
I know.
You could tell that right away, right?
Even when he was in the play.
Absolutely.
Right?
But wait a minute,
yes,
let me say this.
Yes, he was.
He told me about this poem that he wrote, and then he eventually brought it to the radio station. Let me read it. He read it, and I thought it was amazing because I know shy people. I've been shy,
yes.
Probably still am shy, but you're only shy until somebody gives you the opportunity not to be shy.
Exactly.
So I says, Michael, wow, this poem is great. It was sort of like a social justice kind of
okay,
poem.
Okay, I was wondering what the topic
yeah,
was of that.
I don't remember the topic,
uh-huh.
But what I remember about it is this shy guy, Michael, told me he wrote a poem,
uh-huh.
And he was talking about having it, he had already copywritten it, but he was talking about having it published to something, you know, I can't remember exactly what it was, but this shy guy, right? So this is why I gave him the opportunity to have a part in the reading.
Yes, loosen him up a little bit.
Yes. Now the reading of my play, you know, I said to myself, now I know Michael is shy, but he was so instrumental in helping me with my play. I says, well, let me give him this opportunity to do this. And he took it. But he knows that particular part that he had in the play was the part of a singer. And as we go forward, you know, the second phase of our play.
That's right.
Michael did this. He said to me, he says, Edie, I'm not a singer, so I can't continue to be in the play.
Oh, he did?
Oh, he told me this.
Oh, I didn't know that he told you that.
And I was just looking at my phone. Michael and I made a date to go see Master's Touch. And he says that he wanted me to look in that group for the character that he was playing in the play.
Yes.
So we have a date in September 18th. And then they're supposed to be performing, yes, September 18th at the Twilight Tuesday.
Oh,
Michael and I were supposed to be going there together.
Then we need to go.
Yes.
We need to
We're
going to
go and check out Master's Touch,
yes.
and do as Michael said. He wanted one of these guys to have his part.
Isn't that something?
So let's.
We'll have to share that with him.
Yes.
And go together.
I will.
Okay.
I will. Michael Bishop, the Old Soul Harmony Show, KDHX, the show is still on. I don't know how long they're going to run it. I don't know what's going to happen with the show. But I know for sure there are podcasts that people can go back and check out. Michael had a fantastic show every week, and he was just beginning to do a lot of interviews, so he had people booked still.
Yes. So we want you, the audience, to keep that in mind. Write that down, and do try to find out some of the shows that Michael has already recorded and can listen to.
Absolutely. You can go to KDHX and go to Old Soul Harmony Show podcast.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And you can hear Michael that way. I mean, that's one thing that we can be very grateful for, that we do have him on tape.
That's right.
You know, doing some of his shows.
That's
and
right.
I'm going to find that play. I'm going to find that poem. I'm going to get it from his wife, Sharon, and ask her if I could post it on Facebook
as well, so we could have the audience listen.
Absolutely.
I'd like to also say that Michael left us very early Saturday morning, September 1st, or it could have been very late on Friday.
Friday night, Saturday morning.
Exactly. Edie and I had both been at separate times to visit with Mike at DePaul Hospital when Edie first mentioned it to me, and I was so very happy to go over and see him.
Yeah, I took him a plant from all of us from the Jazz and My Soul group, expressing our condolences to the family.
Thank you.
Yes.
I didn't know that you took a plant over, but I had the pleasure of meeting his family, cousins, two of the females, Linda and a gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
So we cried together, and we shared the memories with one another
mm-hmm.
about Michael. And all we can say is that
he's
going to
be dearly missed. He loved his family, exactly. talked about his family
exactly.
all the time. And we just don't know how long we have. You know, and we're at the age to where all of our brothers and sisters are leaving us. I mean, I'm 65.
And I'm 62.
Okay. And, you know.
You just never know. Nothing's for granted.
Right. And we have to cherish who we love.
That's right.
I mean, when you hug them a little bit tighter.
And mean it.
Because you never know.
That's right.
You never know.
Michael Bishop, radio personality for many, many years, as a graduate of Beaumont High School here in St. Louis,
okay.
class of 1974. Mm-hmm. I do know that some of the classmates are aware of his passing already, but those of you that are listening that did not know, please share that mm-hmm. and check your Facebook pages, as Edie and I will both be posting mm-hmm. something sometime very soon, okay?
Yes.
In regards to his services and that sort of thing.
Absolutely.
Okay. We appreciate you taking the time out of your day, first of all, listening to the show, and Edie and myself, in regards to Michael Bishop, again, passed away, our longtime friend and very, very dear, loved friend. Our condolences go out to all of the family, friends afar and those here in the area. So
thank you, Sheila, for
I love you, Edie, for coming in, and you know I love you anyway.
Thank you. You know, there's not very many of
us
who can open up our mics and on our shows, because there's not very many of us who have our own shows. But those of us who do, and I appreciate you doing this for Michael. He was such a sweetheart.
Yes, he was. Yes, he was.
Okay.
I just prayed for him to come around, but it wasn't his time.
Yeah.
So we have to move on.
Absolutely. And Michael would not want us to make a fuss over him.
I know.
I just know it. But I know he would want us to remember his show.
That's
and
right.
I want everybody to go to KDHX, Old Soul Harmony Show. And when you just want to chill out, you know, check out Michael's podcast.
88.1.
What did I say?
KDHX 88.1.
88.1, yes.
Yes, just absolutely. Wanted to put that in there.
Okay.
I didn't know if you had mentioned it, but
yes.
I just wanted to put
absolutely.
That in there, okay?
Thank you, Sheila.
All right, love to all of you for listening again. Thank you. We're going to close it out with Michael's song. We've got about 3 minutes left on this song. Again, this is John Coltrane.
John Coltrane,
yeah.
Dear Lord.
Dear
I mean, it's a classic.
Lord.
It's a classic.
Yeah,
and that's the way
he chose that song.
That's the way he started his show every Saturday with that song. Yeah. Yes.
We're closing our interview
okay.
with, amongst one another
okay.
with him.
Very
in
good.
In honor of Michael. We love you, Michael. God bless the family. Stay tuned and listen to the rest of the song. We'll be back after this. Dear friend, John Coltrane from the 1970 CD, Transitions. The song is called Dear Lord. John Coltrane on tenor sax, McCoy Tyner on piano, Jimmy Garrison on double bass, and Elvin Jones on drums. Goodbye, Michael. We love you. We love you so much.